Hello to all our followers and welcome to this new episode of 5 Minutes. Today we talk about double-edged sword, persistent effects of communism on life satisfaction with our guest Professor Milena Nikolova, Associate Professor and Rosalind Franklin Fellow at the University of Groningen. Milena, very welcome to 5 Minutes. It's a great honor and a great pleasure to have you here with us. Milena, you have written very extensively about life satisfaction in transition economies like countries of the former Soviet bloc. What do we mean by life satisfaction and why is it so important?
Yeah, thank you, Luca, also for the very kind introduction. It's a pleasure to be on the 5 minutes. So, yeah, that's a very good question. So, life satisfaction is actually a self-reported and subjective measure of well-being. So that's in contrast with maybe some more traditional measures of well-being that we have out there that your viewers are more familiar with, like, for example, unemployment or incomes or etc. So life satisfaction, in contrast, is about how respondents themselves perceive their overall well-being. And the idea behind these measures is that how we perceive our circumstances and our overall life situations is just as important as these objective circumstances themselves. And so one of the reasons why we care about life satisfaction is because it can tell us additional information that we might miss when we're just looking at measures such as income or unemployment.
Thank you. So, Milena, during the Cold War, individuals could be connected with the communist regime by being Communist Party members or by being secret police informants. What was the difference between these two ties?
Yeah, that's an interesting question. So what we know about these two groups is that they were both somehow regime near. So they were both were let's say, trustees of the former communist regimes, but in very, very different ways. So the Communist Party members or the former Communist Party members were actually an elite group. They were typically opportunists and rent seekers who oftentimes saw the party membership as a career ladder, as a something to as a means to achieve something in life. The members were actually mainly white collar. Of course, that doesn't mean that they didn't have workers in the party. Not at all, they did. But the members were actually highly educated white collar workers, typically working in the administration, and they enjoyed a lot of economic and other privileges, so access to nicer jobs, places in the kindergarten for their children, getting a car, getting an apartment or a house from the government, etc. And then, in contrast with this, let's say, mainly privileged group, we had the group of informants, and that was a difficult group to pin down. So they were at most 1% of the population. We don't quite know because in many countries, the records of who was an informant to the secret police are not public. But what we know is that they came from all walks of life. Yeah, so they were sometimes uneducated, sometimes highly educated. And what was common for this group is that typically they were in a way blackmailed into this role, and typically the regimes would use some sort of some sort of compromising information about these individuals or their families, and through that coerce them into reporting on their family, on their friends, on their colleagues, and so this group was not in the public eye, so to say, and it was not a privileged group the way that the Communist Party members were, but was again working for the government and trusted in some way by them.
So what are the implications nowadays of having a former secret police informant in the family or a former Communist Party member in the family?
After the fall of communism in Central and Eastern Europe and the Baltics, typically citizens in the new regimes wanted to get rid of the communist past. So there was this movement towards decommunization. Yeah. So, and in many of these countries in Central and Eastern Europe and the Baltics, they actually published publicly the lists of who was an informant, who had ties to the Communist Party, and so these people actually became exposed and faced a lot of public backlash. So in many cases they couldn't work for in different government jobs. There were so-called lustration laws prohibiting that, so you had to show that you have not had anything to do with the former regime if you wanted to have particular jobs. And in the former Soviet Union countries, none of that happened. So the former communist elites continued being elite in some shape or form in the new regime. And even to this day, we still don't know who was actually serving as an informant. So these lists have not been made public in the majority of these countries. And so that has implications for what we find. So what we find actually is that actually having been connected to the former communist regimes is a negative thing. It still has a negative implication for the life satisfaction of those living in Central and Eastern Europe, but is a positive thing for the life satisfaction for those who live in the former Soviet Union countries. So here we can see that these two fates, these two completely different trajectories that people had after the fall of communism, really determined the life satisfaction levels of those connected to the Communist Party in the two regions. And then informants. What we find regarding informants is that, well, there is not much going on in terms of having been connected to informants for those living in Central and Eastern Europe. But having been connected to informants, so either through family or having been one yourself, is actually negatively associated with life satisfaction in the former Soviet Union. And we think that that's because these individuals are afraid that their records will be made public at some point in time. So they're still living in fear, so to say.
So, last question, which lessons and warnings we can take from this?
The former regimes had such a persistent effect on the lives of those connected to them in the past. And more specifically, what we find is that these regimes created, let's say, clear groups of winners and losers, even among those who were trusted by them in one shape or in some shape or form. So the winners of these former communist regimes, based on our analysis, were clearly the former Communist Party members and their families in the former Soviet Union countries. And we also identify clear losers. So those who had former Communist Party membership connection in Central Eastern Europe and the informants in the former Soviet Union. And so, what happens in the past still has implications for our lives today. And unfortunately, not always in a positive way. So that's a broader lesson.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Milena, for this very insightful discussion. And we wish you all the best, and we hope to see you here again at 5 Minutes.
Thank you, Luca.